Hi everyone and welcome to ABCs of Anaesthesia. Now thanks very much for everyone who wrote in to ask me some questions. So we had an Ask Me Anything kind of episode just recently, so thanks for putting in all your questions and I'll try to get through all of them. So one of the most common questions that I get asked is, can you rescue a failed IV cannulation attempt? So let's get started. So I want to start off by saying, in a word, no. That's probably the easiest way to answer the question. And now we'll go through a few of the reasons why. So first of all, what do I mean? So firstly, the situation is you've got an adult patient, you want to do a peripheral venous access, so it's not a central vein, it's not an internal jugular vein or a femoral vein or subclavian vein or something like that, it's a peripheral vein. And what happens is you attempt IV cannulation. First of all, imagine that you have a vein and it just exists like that. Now you insert your needle and cannula. So that's a needle and that's the cannula on top of it. Sorry for my drawing. And then you try to push the cannula off. So it's not, the cannula's not inside the vein. You haven't advanced it far enough. Therefore, you have a failed attempt at cannulation. You do get flashback, however, so you get blood into the chamber. So you're definitely in the vessel. The second option is you enter the vein, you get flashback, but then you go through one of the other walls. So again, there's your needle and plastic cannula over the top. You get the flashback because you're in the vessel, but then you go through one of the other walls and now you can't feed your plastic cannula over. Again, you failed that cannulation attempt. Now what we're not talking about is, let's say you have an IV cannula insertion attempt and you pass the needle maybe a bit too superficially, maybe it's to one side of it, maybe it's underneath it somehow. We're not talking about that situation. So the needle hasn't entered into the vein, therefore the vein is still intact. The blood's still flowing, there's no puncture sites on the vein, which means that vein is still probably able to be accessed. Now, first of all, before we go into why I think you can't rescue a failed cannulation attempt, if the vein has enough elastic tissue and it's thick enough, and it's able to clot well and just close that gap, this is not for those circumstances. Now, when do those circumstances occur? That's pretty much in pediatric patients or where you have really large vessels, and these vessels are like central veins. So imagine that you've got really nice, large, elastic vein walls. See, if you do puncture that vessel, you've got this hole there, but fortunately the vein is able to close it up and you don't have any problems. The vein still works. And that often happens with central veins and to a lesser extent, but still possible with pediatric veins. So what I'm going to say is that in that situation where you've got an adult patient and you're doing peripheral IV access and your vein isn't one of those thick-walled veins like a central vein, so it's peripheral, and you've definitely gone into the vein, so you've got flashback of blood into the chamber, I'm going to say it's just too high risk, especially in critical care, anesthetics, emergency situations, to use that site of that vein. You can still use the vein more proximally if you give enough distance, but it's just too risky to access that vein around where you first had the attempt. So why do I think this is too high risk? So this is why. Imagine you've entered the vein, like we showed before, and the cannula isn't in, so you can't feed it off. Now you have a puncture site here in which blood can flow out of. So let's say you withdraw the cannula and try again to feed off that cannula. So you've re-angled the needle. Now you've pulled it out, you've put it back in, and so you've got the needle there. And let's say you get the cannula in this time. So now you've fed the cannula through, and maybe it's working fine. But what you've got here is a problem. Now you've got a puncture site, and maybe even two puncture sites, depending on how the failure occurred. And now you're going to be giving medicines that may go out and extravasate or leak out into the tissues. So I'm going to say that in the anesthesia and crit care situation, this is a lot more high risk. For example, a lot of the situations we're in are a lot more urgent. For example, you know, you give an induction agent, the blood pressure drops, the heart rate changes depending on the surgery, or maybe there's a rapid change in vital signs. Suddenly you need to give medications like metaraminol, ephedrine, even adrenaline that need to get back to the heart and out to the organs and vasculature immediately. And so if you have any question about whether this is extravasating, you do not know and you're adding extra variables into the system and you need to absolutely make sure that that's not the case. One of the other reasons, it's more toxic. So a lot of the drugs we use, for example, thiopentone, muscle relaxants, even opioids, they're more toxic. They have a very low, narrow therapeutic range, and they can also cause damage to tissues. So imagine, you know, thiopentone extravasating into your tissues can cause tissue necrosis. Same with other medications like metaraminol. If you get it into your tissues, it causes intense vasoconstriction, and you don't want that to happen. Imagine opioids extravasate. Opioids, especially the stuff we use in anesthesia, are so potent, so efficacious, that you want to make sure that there's no deposits in your subcutaneous tissue or your fat that might act later and you don't even know about it. So again, extrication of these medications is really hazardous, plus it may not actually be being delivered to the organs that require it. Imagine that circumstance where you're running propofol tiva for a patient who's got high risk of nausea or vomiting, and let's say that drip wasn't quite, you weren't quite sure it was in and you salvaged it. Imagine all that propofol leaking out into the tissues. And on one hand, it's not going to the patient, keeping them asleep, and on the other hand, you'll be getting propofol into the tissues, which again isn't ideal at all. Now, one of those things that hopefully never happens to you is that some medications are very painful in the skin. So this includes propofol, rock uronium, cefazolin. If this leaks out into the skin, it can cause a lot of pain as well. Now finally, often we have to resuscitate with large volumes of fluid. This could be in the situation of anaphylaxis or rapid blood loss or something that's happening in a trauma situation or with a high bleed risk surgery. And when we're giving that intraoperative fluid rapidly, again, you want to make sure that it's going straight into the vein and back into the circulation. So overall, look, my threshold for being suspicious about a cannula is far higher than in other circumstances. So to answer that question, would you ever try to rescue a failed IV cannulation attempt? My answer is no, for all those reasons. So thanks very much for watching. Any questions, please write in the comments below and yeah, share with anyone who might be interested in this content. See you next time.